morning. Good morning, good morning.
Good morning.
Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. Amen. We are, again, going to just exhort people in the worship of the blessing of God and just invite you to prepare your hearts if you're tuning in now or later at whatever point God is speaking. And I just wanted to say also, this week the Lord is putting on my heart that His people, with ears open and hearts open, He is going to clearly instruct on what is happening, what He is asking of, you know, the body of Christ to arise, to really take their place. What does that mean today? What does it mean in the times when Jesus was teaching? He came on earth and He taught. That's what the Lord is going to speak to us through Albert today on. You know, what were those things? What was the command? You know, when Jesus was here, when Jesus gave us the last word, it's not just what you came to do, but what was the final, you know, the final most important things. And so, you know, ultimately God wants us to live in that blessing. So we're just going to pray briefly and jump into the worship. So Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity. We praise you because you are in the midst of your people, people that have contrite hearts, people that are ready, that are on fire, whether it's live, whether it's going to be later, but it's going to be a work of your move, of your presence. And Father God, we just thank you that our hearts are prepared, our spirits are renewed, and we thank you, God, that your glory manifests through hearts. As a child, as children, the hearts that are innocent and pure and receptive and full of faith, in Jesus' name, thank you, God. Thank you, Father. We worship you. We praise you, Lord. We thank you, God, that over your presence, over your people is filling them with your confidence, with your boldness, with your courage. Commanded for 1,000 generations. So receive that today in Jesus' name. Lord bless. Thank you, Jesus. So we're just going to prepare our hearts for this refreshing, strong word. And just pray that God will bless you. In Jesus' name, I'm going to go fix the mic here.
Okay, so today it will be our subject, the ultimate commandment of Jesus. It displays in 7 examples. We will read in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20. Teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Are you teaching what Jesus commanded you? Are you living and teaching what Jesus commanded you? The ultimate commandment of Jesus, his order to us, was to teach others to observe all things he commanded us. And he promised to be with us in the process to the end of the age. The following our living foundation Jesus gave us in his teachings. First, in John chapter 13, verse 34, a new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. The first and the ultimate commandment of Jesus was to love one another as he loved us. So Jesus, he said, go and teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you. So this, the first ultimate commandment of Jesus was to love one another. Do you love your brother and sister in Christ as Jesus loved you? This means that if Jesus were to ask you specifically on behalf of a brother or sister in Christ, would you be ready to sacrifice your time to pray for the person and care for them by encouraging them and supporting them, even if it meant risking your life as he did? The Apostle James said in James chapter 2, verse 16, if one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? How can you say to your brother or sister, stay warm, well fed, if you don't give them food to eat? Faith without work is dead. This is especially true for brothers and sisters in Christ before caring for all unbelievers. Even Paul said, we must first care about the family of God, the brothers and sisters in Christ. So for sure, we help everybody. We support everybody. But first, the family of God. First, because they have the need, because we are our family. At the same time, we are more persecuted than the others. So they need more support and help. So this is the first commandment, ultimate commandment of Jesus, to love one another as he loved us. The second one, in Luke chapter 13, verse 24. Strive to enter through the narrow door, for many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. The second instruction I want to point of Jesus teaching that to represent his ultimate commandment is that we would teach others to strive to enter in the narrow way that leads to life. And also Jesus said also in Matthew chapter 7, verse 14, but small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. So what Jesus commanded us to teach to observe others is that it's very few people, few will find it. And it says strive. Why strive? It's not an easy way. It's a narrow way. It's narrow gate. Because why it says few find it? Because few wants to live the truth. Few wants to obey Jesus. Few wants to walk in the narrow way because it's a difficult way. it's our flesh, our old man is always susceptible, yes, to go to always in the broad way, easy way. I'm not saying it's difficult, but it says strive to enter in the narrow gate. It's you have to make a big effort. What is the effort? You only need to trust Jesus and let the Holy Spirit to lead you. Otherwise, you can never find that way. And many will say, many will try to enter from that gate. They won't be able. Why? Because they are not asking that Jesus leads them in their life. They are not giving to Jesus to become the king of their life, of their heart, of everything. They must give everything. For that reason said, few will find it. It says few will be saved. Because many people, it says, because they didn't accept the truth to be saved, God will send them the spirit of delusion to believe the lie. So if you want to be in that narrow way that leads to life, and to be saved, we have to only trust Jesus. You must only follow Jesus.
Thank you, God.
So I will speak about the third point, which is, it completes the second point. So the third one is repentance and living in holiness. In Luke chapter 9, verse 23, it says, then he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Denying yourself is the act of repentance daily. This is what Jesus meant when he told the woman caught in adultery. Jesus said to her, go and sin no more. Means deny yourself, deny your sins, deny everything. Only follow me. So the first one, which is the repentance, you have to deny yourself. Pick up your cross. We know the bearing of a cross is a heavy. And to live in holiness is a heavy standard in today's world. When it comes to living as he instructed us to in the midst of this wicked generation, it's a heavy thing to live holiness between this generation. You only hear the bad things all around you, but you have to pick up your cross. Even it is a heavy, because Jesus, with Jesus, everything becomes so light. Light, so light, because his burden is not heavy. The burden of Jesus, that give your burden to Jesus. Give Jesus your dirtiness and he will give you holiness.
Hallelujah. Yes.
I spoke another time about it. Hallelujah. So give him your dirtiness. Give him your sins. Repent. Pick up your cross. You will see it. It will be so light when you are with Jesus. Because he will carry about the cross with you. He will help you. The Holy Spirit will give you the power to live the holiness.
Hallelujah.
To live the power of his resurrection.
Praise
in your life.
God.
So the problem today is the Lord's house, the family of God. It says many have completely stopped preaching of repentance and living in his holiness. Brothers and sisters, the judgment will begin in the house of God. Many of them, they abandoned this preaching of repentance and holiness. It says the last days they will gather a big number of doctors. They will be preaching preaching only itching to ears. So most they abandoned the preaching of the repentance and holiness. So they only seek people about itching to ears. It's not the purpose. God, he wants us to teach the repentance and holiness, because
Hallelujah.
Without holiness we can never see God. This is the only way to see God. But some people, they say to me, okay, we can see him after that or something. No. Jesus, you can see him now. He is alive.
Glory.
He says, who keep my commandments, me and my Father will come and dwell with him.
Thank you, God.
I myself will reveal to him.
Abide.
So Jesus is alive. You can see him now if you live holiness. So the third one, number four, is the ultimate commandment of Jesus in our fourth example is humility. In Matthew chapter 20, verse 26. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Jesus commanded us to live and teach humility. Most people want to or seek to become great in order for others to serve them. But in our Christ likeness, we must not be like this world. We are called to be humble and serve others as our Master, who humbled himself even to the point of the death. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 to 11, I won't read it all maybe, but only a small part, but I love it so much. We read, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant, and coming in the likeness of man, and being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of the death, even the death of the cross. So therefore God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on earth and those of under earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." So you want to get God exalt his glory in your life. How can he exalt you if you are not living humility in your life? If you are not humbling to God, says Peter says, "Humble under hand of God, and he will exalt you in the right time, due time." So you must humble yourself before God. Live, serve others. Don't seek that others serve you. Jesus didn't call us to that we become masters. He called us to become servants, to serve others. He gave us the biggest example. He humbled himself. He left his glory. He manifested in flesh for you.
Thank you, Jesus.
You must humble also yourself so you can the same time be exalted like God, like the Father exalted Jesus as Son of Man. Jesus is God, but as Son of Man, he exalted him because he humbled himself to the point, to the death.
Amen.
So now you must die for yourself, for your old man, for your desires, so God can exalt his glory in your life, first here on earth, and then in heaven forever and ever.
Praise you, Father.
Number 5. The ultimate commandment of Jesus in our fifth reflection is purity. John chapter 13, verse 8. "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." Jesus commanded us to be purified through his blood every day of our lives. Peter said, "Wash my whole body." He who is already purified needs only to wash his feet. The feet represent our contact with this world. When we hear, speak, or see things that can defile us, we need Jesus to wash us so we can stay pure. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 8, it says, Jesus said, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." And in John chapter 1, verse 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no deceit." Because Nathanael, he was observing and he was reading the word of God, and that tree, fig tree. Jesus said, "I saw you when you were sitting on that fig tree." So this pureness of God comes when we always in his presence, like Mary has chosen the good part, which will never be taken from her. The purity is not in us. We are completely dirty, but Jesus washed us with his blood. And he gave us that purity so we can stay pure. So we have
Thank
to.
You,
Jesus
God.
Commanded us to teach others to stay pure. Paul said to Timothy, he says that flee your desires and seek to worship God with people that have pure hearts. Are you seeking to be people to pure hearts? Or you don't care about anything, you only care which is near to me, which is no. You have to seek people that they have pure heart.
Thank
so you can
God.
That you can be example one for another.
Hallelujah.
So We have to give, let Jesus to purify our hearts. Like we said the other day, we must cast all these little foxes that it says that they spoils the vines. So you have to let Jesus to purify your hearts. He says, blessed that they are pure in heart, they will see God. You will see God in your life. How David, he saw God in his life. I put the Lord before me because on my right hand, I will never be shaken. Purity comes from him. He is pure.
Glory.
He is pure. He can give you his purity in you. So you can see God, see his presence in your life, and you can worship him all the time. Number 7. Important teaching I want to bring attention to wrapped in the ultimate commandment Jesus gave us is you must be an empty vessel. First, and day by day, Jesus will give you what is you are to teach others. Not rooted in your own understanding. If, for example, you decide and assume that you know too much and you also know the Bible by heart, your heavenly teachings and revelation, you are closing the door to our Lord. Jesus then stopped giving you heavenly teaching and revelation understanding. So if you know too much, you are full of knowledge. The revelation stops. You know the Bible by heart, it's very good. The devil knows. It says, you know, God is one, the devil knows, and trembles. So your knowledge will not help God to give you revelations to teach others. So you need that revelation comes directly from Jesus. It says, not with bread that man lives, but with every word that comes from the mouth of God. You need that revelation that comes from him. You must be empty vessels. Don't lean on your own understanding. Don't lean on your own knowledge. You know the Bible by heart. The devil knows. You are not better than the devil. But if you know, because you know Jesus, for that reason, you will be changed. If you are an empty vessel in the hand of God, God will fill you with his revelation. It says, without revelation, people are perished. And in Matthew chapter 11, verse 25, at that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank you, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have did these things for the wise, hid this thing from the wise and prudent, and have revealed them to babes. If you think you are perfectly wise and prudent on your own, he will hide mysteries from you. He will give and minister his teachings to babes, which represents in all simplicity empty vessels who consider themselves as nothing and useless apart from him. And these are those who will use for his glory. So if you think that what you did, everything, your teachings, all teachings, that a number, we won't speak also another thing, teach others the whole truth and nothing but the truth and guide people with your teaching to Jesus. If the content of what you teach does not guide people to Jesus, your teaching and its message is vain. In Matthew chapter 7, 24 to 27. Therefore, whoever hears their saying of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. As the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house and did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall. So, Jesus asked you, he commanded you to teach all the truth and nothing only but the truth. But if you are teaching people not hold the truth, and if you are not, your faith is not founded on Jesus, on the rock of salvation, your house, it says it will fall, and it great was it fell, its fall. So you have to only be teach people the truth, hold the truth. You mustn't keep or hide anything from the truth, because if your faith and your love and your teaching is founded, the foundation is Jesus, then everything will change completely. Because Jesus, he will give you that power to teach people only the truth. Because sometimes if we speak half of the truth, it's a lie. So this is the problem what's happening in many places. They are teaching the truth, but half of it, not all of it. For that reason, Jesus, your teaching is in vain, because it's not guiding people to Jesus. It's only guiding people to some places or to only to go to church. It's not the going to church is the importance. It's going to Jesus is more important, because if the person has the fellowship with Jesus and his faith is founded on Jesus, he will share any place he goes, in a place, in assembly, in any place. He will be an example. He will shine. His light will shine everywhere that he goes. He will be a light and salt in everywhere that he goes. So we have to teach the others what Jesus commanded us, not things from us. You must receive that teachings from Jesus directly. For that reason, go and says observe the teach them of that of they observe what I commanded you, that people observe. So these teachings must come from Jesus. It's not be by your own understanding, but you must teach always the repentance and holiness. Because only through repentance and holiness, in living in life of repentance, living in holiness, we can enter in God, in kingdom of heaven. So if your teaching is not guiding people to Jesus, he says, they don't enter, they don't let the others enter. This is the Pharisees, they were teaching things that they don't let people enter to heaven. So your teaching must be founded on Jesus. The ultimate commandment of Jesus is to be that you take from Jesus and give to people, not far by your own understanding, not by your theology that you were taught. No, only on Jesus. It must be by revelation. It must be by revelation, not by speculations. It's not what you think is good. What Jesus thinks is good, because he is the source of the living water. If you drink from him, you can give others. If you're taught by Jesus, if you drink from Jesus, the water that Jesus gives you, you can give that water to the others also. Otherwise, you are giving them a false doctrines, or you're giving them half-truth, which doesn't guide them to Jesus. You have to speak all the truth, even if it hurts people, even if it hurts you, because sometimes. But you have to speak the truth and live the truth. Are we living and teaching what Jesus commanded us? This is the ultimate commandment of Jesus. I will put this challenge before you so you can live that life. That we can live that life, living and teaching the others what Jesus commanded us. Not every word, not with only with bread that man lives, but with every word that comes from mouth of God. You have to listen to Jesus, his voice. You have to listen from him, and he will tell you what you have to speak. Don't prepare for things to speak. Ask Jesus revelation, 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 not speculation, not on understanding, in Jesus only. Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
Lord is right here. He's actually waiting. He is the one cheering more for us than we are thinking we're cheering for him. He's actually for us. He's more for us than we are for him. He says, if you can understand the dimension of the depth of that love in action for you that I have, says the Lord, then you would be completely overwhelmed and completely surrendered. So that's his intent, just because he created you and he loves you. Thank you, Lord.
Raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. Oh, I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm.
In the middle of the storm, louder and louder.
He's worthy. He's worthy. He loves you. We love you, and we're going to keep declaring it. I encourage you to be a fire of God, wherever God sends you, and to impact people's lives with his love, with his power, with his truth. Amen. The true holiness, the true life of his presence. In Jesus' name.
Have a good day, a wonderful in Jesus.
Amen.